And then a few classes later, we'll start discussion of time. Okay, let's complete the discussion that we were having the end of the last class, about correct some algebra. So, the discussion that we were having was as follows. We were trying to solve Einstein's equations in a systematic expansion in weakness of the forces, or equivalently in velocities of the fields. These two things are equivalent because if the force is strong, it accelerates things to higher distances. Okay? And you remember that this Newtonian idea gives you that phi of Newtonian potential is a model of reason. Okay? And leading non-trivial order, we had the equation that dx squared is equal to now 1 minus 2 f by r, which is 1 plus 2 phi dt squared, minus 1 minus 2 phi dx I dx. Okay. Now, this result we could obtain by solving the equations we wrote down for the metric and curvatures and so on. And we effectively do that by checking that it works for the first order thing. But we can also obtain the way we obtained last class, just to remind you, was not very that complicated procedure. It was by noting that we have the exact solution for a given mass. Okay? For a given mass at rest. And that exact solution was the Schwarzschild solution. Now, at leading order, the equation for the linearized H is linearized. So superposition is. So if you know what the fluctuation metric is for one mass, and leading order can be good for all masses. Okay? And you might object that look, we only knew what the fluctuation metric was for a mass that was at rest. But velocity that was already a order of square. And velocity introduces one higher order of smallness into that. So if you boost that. It's one higher order of smallness, so that's order b cube. So the leading order, which is order b squared, we don't even need to worry about the boosts. Okay? And so how did we get this formula precisely? You remember we started from the metric of Schwarzschild and Dipole, which was one plus 2 phi in the dt squared. And almost this metric, it was minus 1 minus 2 phi into dr squared plus minus r squared into d omega 2 squared. Now this metric is not quite the same. Because this guy multiplies not just dr squared but also r squared d omega 2 squared. Okay? However, it's possible to go between these two metrics by quadratic. I mentioned this last class, but let me just show that to you. Let me just show that to you more explicitly. Okay. Suppose you look at a quadratic transformation where zeta alpha, so we're looking at a linearized quadrant. Okay? Zeta alpha is equal to some number prefix 2 times x alpha divided by r. Okay? Now I want to see what change in the metric this kind of quadratic transformation means. So we know the formula for the change in the metric. The formula for the change in the metric is delta H alpha beta. So I will do it only in the I dimension. R is spatial R, say one dimension. Okay? And I is run over spatial dimension. No time. Okay? So delta H, delta E is one of the 0 dimensions. And delta H I j is equal to del I zeta j plus del j zeta I. And depending on, there may be a minus sign here. I'll just skip this. Okay. Now, let's evaluate this for this particular quadrant change. So this particular quadrant change for me, del I xj divided by r plus del j of xi divided by r. Del I and del j can act two places. Good idea. So let's look at the terms you get when it actually is. That gives you delta ij with a factor of 2 divided by r. Okay? And let's look at what happens when the del I and del j act here. That gives you a minus, minus sign, minus. And now let's think of r as equal to square root of xi xj. So we get minus 1 by r cube xj xi, and again the same thing. Okay. Now, this can be thought of as 2 times delta ij by r minus r I hat r j hat by r. But can you say that dr squared, when written in terms of Schwarzschild quadrants, in a Cartesian quadrant, is simply r I hat r j hat dx I dx j? Obviously, because r I hat projects onto the r. Whereas delta I change is just delta I change. So if you add this quadrant change with the correct coefficient, it will cancel this term in the Schwarzschild metric, but add instead the corresponding term with r, with the dr squared here replaced by dx I dx. Okay? If I've got all my signs right, I will be careful with the signs, but if I've got all my signs right, this number we will have to choose as 1/2. So that would be. Okay? And then this added to this small deviation, that small deviation in the Schwarzschild metric in that space, would give you this. Okay, this is a much more convenient starting point for our expansion than the Schwarzschild metric, because it doesn't make a particular choice, it doesn't single out a particular choice of function. It doesn't break the rotational isometry in space. Okay, so this was a starting point. I sort of briefly mentioned this last class, but I thought I could emphasize that we get this from the Schwarzschild metric after transformation. Okay? So, to leave the corner, our solution to Einstein's equation was given as we just mentioned, was s squared is equal to 1 plus 2 to 5 in a dt squared minus 1 minus 2 to 5 in a dxi dx chain. Now, then the next question was, well, how can we go to one higher order? Okay. We determined to work to order which before. Okay? So, you know, now we want the effect, the single particle Lagrangian to order which before. Okay? In order to do that, you remember we argued that we needed H0, 0 to order which before. H0, I in order to order which cube. And Hij to order which square. Because that's how it enters into the square root direction. Is this clear? Okay? So then we're going ahead and proceeding to compute. Thank you. Okay. Now, so this eta, you know, the idea of kung fu we've already obtained. Just from this expression. You know, of course, phi is the Newtonian equation. So, L squared phi is equal to by L. Is it 4 pi k times m a delta r. Yeah, this is happening. Okay, so phi obeys this equation. So we've already obtained another connection of our to first order we've obtained. Okay? And for HIJ, we don't need to worry about it. We've done it to the order. But we need to go further for 800 and 80i. Now, last time we almost completed finding for 800, we got stuck on a particular point of algebra, but that would be stupid. So, remind you of that connection. The first thing we never did was that we had a nice expression for the stress test. You know, now we want to solve Einstein's equation, we want to know what to do on the right hand side of Einstein's equation. And we have a nice expression for the stress tensor, which was dx mu by d tau, dx mu by d tau, delta of x mu delta 4 by square root g of x mu minus x mu of tau times n. Okay, summed over all. But this is x a t. Okay, we've got a bunch of particles, x later right at the day, then each are undergoing some motion. This is the expression for the stress tensor. And by taking this expression and integrating, this is the four-dimensional delta function. This whole thing is integrated over the world line of each particle. By doing this integral, we equivalently wrote this as d, so this was d mu mu. So equivalently wrote t mu mu as t mu mu is equal to dx mu by d tau dx mu by dt and the three dimensions divided by square root. Does you remember? This is probably that you might lack derivations. It's possible that it's written this form, then it's nice and coherent. But from here, that's all. Okay. Now, the next thing we did was to process T00. So T00, and I'm just reminding you this. Since if we just go to calculation. So T00, I'm going to these laws. Okay? You remember it was sufficient just to write this as G00 squared of T00. Because we were only interested in T00 lower up to order B squared. Okay? And the terms with T0i times H0i were at least of order B. Because T0i itself is of order H0i is order B cube and T0i is order B. Okay, so we can ignore. And then this was written in a nice form. It was written as G00 pi squared by square root G. And then we wrote this as X mu dot divided by the square root factor, where the square root factor was G00 minus VI, effectively minus this. That is full Lorentz invariant VS by DT, but I'm truncating the variable. Okay? So, of course, if we expand this. Okay. So, in doing this, we got a square of G is like an additional factor of G00 in this. There's a what? Sorry. So this is one. Yes. And so if you say that square root g, you know, we're going to take 1 plus 2, 5 expanded in here. Okay? So I'm saying that square root, that this part, to the order of interest, is effectively like g0, 0, or anything 2. Because this is 1 plus 2, 5, the whole thing, square, is g0, 0, 0 square. But then square root g was 1 minus 2, 5. 1 minus 2, 5. But 1 minus 2, 5, the denominator says 1 plus 2, 5, here. Okay? Which is this one. So that was like a g0, 0 cube, and then that was effectively g0, 0 minus b squared. Now, we took put g0, 0 as 1 plus 2, 5, expanded the square root in that. Taking both phi and the square is small, and we found that this was 1 plus 5 phi plus b squared by 2. Okay, so t0, 0 was equal to 1 plus 5 phi plus b squared by 2. Yeah. Okay? Time is a spatial data function. And that's all. Okay? So this is the effective stress energy tensor of this collection of particles. The energy part of it. Okay? For t0i, we're only going to be interested, remember, h0i to order vq. T0i, the simple contribution is just already. It's in the NAVI. Okay. The next connection to this is order VQ, and then by inverting the equation, we get an additional square. So this is all that we do. For our purposes, these are the formulas. We only need to go to higher order T0i. Okay? Okay, then the next thing we did was to try to solve magnetic equations. Okay, so I just quoted this formula that R0 zero zero was equal to del by del t of H0 alpha, del H0 alpha by del X alpha minus half. Del H alpha, lambda Lucius uses alpha for space and I for space time. We got into that by using alpha for space time and I for space. I'll stick to R. Okay. Plus half del spatial del squared. Of h0, 0 plus half hij del squared h0, 0 by del xi del xj minus 1 by 4 del h0, 0 by del xi del x squared minus 1 by 4 del h0, 0 by del xi del 2 del h I j by del x I this was a g, let's say minus del h I by del x j. There are no upper and lower indices in the i's. Upper and lower, same as size and such. We're raising and lowering just by there's no way. Okay, so we have this formula for algebra. Then we continue by adopting a gauge, and the gauge condition we adopted was that this term is So what we were left with were these terms in R0, 0. And then we wrote down Einstein's equations. Okay, so we wrote down Einstein's equations. Oh, but before doing that, we wrote down the formula for horizons. Now, you see, in R0, 0, there is one term that's unknown, which is del square the order of b to the 4th power of a0. But the remaining terms are all already of order b to the 4th. That is, the remaining terms are all quadratic in h's. H is at least of order b square. So the remaining terms are already of order b to the 4th, just by plugging in the order b square contribution to h. So the logic of perturbation getting all the remaining terms should be thought of as known. But the only unknown term is del square of the order b to the 4 b sub h. Is this clear? So in this expression, here I will keep this is unknown. But in the rest, I just plug in the order b square part of h. Is this clear? Okay? Now, this part, if we manage to do correctly, this is the next step that we will start. So then I will give you this part as well. What did we do? Let's see. Here we have to be careful. So remember that h00 is equal to 5. Hij is also equal to 5. But that meant that hij was equal to minus 1. It's minus size. Okay? So now, with this in mind, let's evaluate these terms for you. Okay? So this guy here is simply 2 phi, so that's plus sign, because both are, times half times del square of n star. Plus. On the other hand, this guy here is del 2 phi the whole thing squared with the minus 1 there. Okay? This guy here was minus 1 by 4 times this is 2 phi del I. And here we have to get this was into 2 into delta I j. So effectively del I of 2 phi, but with a minus. Because 1 plus 1 lower. And this was with a plus, because of the squares with the 3. So plus 3 into del I of 2 phi. Okay? So let's put all this together. This stuff is 2 phi del square phi. And this stuff here, the 4 cancels 2 into 2. There's plus 3 minus 2, but then there's an over on minus sign. So it's plus 1. No, so it's minus 1. Minus 1, this is also 4 cancels 4, minus 1. So minus 2 del I phi lower than square. Okay? And that is needed for the equations. So, we conclude that R00 is equal to, as far as we're concerned, half del square H00 plus 2 phi del square phi minus 2 del I phi lower than square. Okay? Now, for the next step, what we need to do is solve Einstein's equations. So Einstein's equations were, I mean, the 0, 0 component of Einstein's equations was R00 is equal to 8 pi k times T00 minus half T G0. And here we're going to say that actually somebody pointed out to me at the end of the class. Somebody pointed out that that's too late. And when we were doing last time, the mistake I was making was not including the lowering of the raising of GC0 in this T. Okay, so then we had 8 by K times T00. Now let's write by this. So this is equal to minus half of G00 T00. G00 T00 minus TI times G00. And there are the other terms, which are like T0i, G0i, and so on, but those are not of the order of it. Okay? However, these are all the 10 pieces of the order of it. Now, in the T00 bit, notice that this G00 just cancels. So this is equal to 8 by k into T00 by 2 minus PII. Anyway, we worked on last time, we'll take this G00 account, but ignoring this one, which is the important. Of course. Do things. Plus what? But that we don't care about, because it's not a problem. We're only interested in the right hand side of the score. PII is already a problem.
For G0,
multiplies this?
Yes.
It does. G0 equals 1 plus 2 pi.
Okay.
So we just keep the 1 to our list. Okay. Now let's put it what this is. T00 we had somewhere up there. So that's equal to 8 pi k into let's keep by 2. There 1 plus 5 pi plus b squared by 2. And TII is simply plus B squared. The whole thing is the M, E, U, delta. Okay? So, plugging this and R 0, we had somewhere, right? Multiplying the whole equation by 2 by 2. Multiplying the whole equation 2 by 2. We find del squared of 8 0 0 is equal to minus 2 phi del squared phi plus 2 del phi over 2 squared plus 8 pi k by 2 0 1 plus 5 phi plus 3 e squared by 2. And don't come to and then we can hang the 4. Okay, so perfect. Okay, so now this is our equation for del squared. Okay, so now look. One term we get out of this del square of 8 0 0 is just this 8 pi k into 1 into, because this m e delta x minus x x k and sum over all k. Okay? But remember, that phi obeys the equation del squared of phi is equal to 4 pi k m a delta of x minus x a somewhere all a. So this, looking at this, we conclude that first order H is to A0, 0 is to 5. That's a consistency. In your hypothetical, well, it's follows. Okay? So we set A0, 0 is equal to 2, 5 plus order V to the 4, and then we can figure out this. Okay, this is taken down by the 2 5s. Okay? So if we have A0, 0, so we've got L squared of A0, 0, 4 is equal to minus 4, 5, del squared 5, plus 4 del 5 over V squared, plus 8 pi k into 5 pi plus 3 V squared by 2 m a delta of x minus x a sum over a. Well, you must always keep in mind that when I write phi, I just mean the Newtonian potential. Okay? Now we have to solve this equation. Before we even let's try to simplify it. Okay. So, you see, well, that dimension is as usual as a very clever way of simplification. And the clever way goes as follows. Notice that, so we've got this term that's 4 del phi over x squared. This term is very simple. Because del squared phi is the sum of delta functions. By definition, phi is the solution that we the equation we have to use. Okay? So this term is a very simple term. This term looks more complicated. But let's do some manipulation that will help. So suppose let's look at 4 del phi over x squared. Okay? Let me write this as 2 del squared of phi squared minus 4 pi x squared. This is just an identity. Let's try to understand. You see, this term has the terms that are two derivatives acting on the same phi, or terms which have a one derivative on each phi. If two derivatives are going to act in the same phi, it has a choice of which of the phi squared. So there's a factor of 2. Okay? So that will give us 4 phi del squared phi. So the terms where 2 derivatives act in the same phi cancels. What remains is the terms where 1 derivative acts on each phi. Again, there's a factor of 2 because 2 derivatives of the 2 phi that we have in 2 ways. That gives us this. Okay? If it's confusing the way I said it, I think you could just work it out. Yeah, this looks like it's so simple algebra. Okay. So, anyway, you can easily make that sense. Okay? Now, what's the point of this? So, now let's plug this in. So, we get. That's right. Oh, by the way, before we forget, has anyone handed in an homework assignment?
Many of them have.
What?
Many of them have.
Many of them have. Has anyone not handed in the homework assignment? Okay, before the end of this week, we'll definitely have problems and number. Okay. It'll cover the material. Okay, please hand in your homework assignments. Okay. I mean, grading, as you know, is not important in this course. But what is important is that you do homework otherwise. I mean, just so that you know. Okay. So we've got del squared of 0, 0, 4 is equal to minus 4 pi del squared pi. And now what I'll do is take this term, which was from here, I'll take it to the left hand side. So I'll make this del squared of 8, 0, 0 minus 5. Minus 2 phi. Okay? Now, this will become 8. Because this term and this term. Okay? Plus plus 8, 5, k, sum over 8, 5, 5 plus 3 squared by 2, m, a delta of 8 minus xx.
The point is that if you take this formula literally,
because phi is the potential at, this is at I. Phi is the potential at Ra. Phi at Ra diverges because there's an R minus Ra sum over all R minus Rp sum over all B, including R. Okay. Now, the reason for this divergence is that we actually try to deal with these point functions. You know, had we been looking at a distributed connection of matter and point, we wouldn't have got any such divergence. And the end result of doing the whole thing correctly, though I'm just going to assert this without showing you, is that you just replace this phi RA by what other phi prime RA. Which means that the formula of the phi don't include the self edge. Okay, so phi is the potential due to all other objects on this one. That's the end result of doing everything. Okay, taking into account that this finite size. Okay, so there's a subtlety here that if you accept up to the subtlety, you get a nice answer. Okay, I'm just asserting that, doing it carefully. And fine. Now, so we've got this nice formula for A0. Okay, so A00 is equal to 2 at R is equal to 2 phi at R plus 2 phi squared at R and then minus 2k sum over A phi prime R A plus 3 V A squared by 2 M A over R minus R A. This is our final formula for A 0 0 to order it.
Okay, it's not good. I'll just try to judge it.
We want the gauge condition. Exactly. So the gauge condition was del m h m 0 minus half del t of h I. Okay? Now, the important point is that if every time we have del m h m 0, we can replace it by hmm. And that's what we have here. Here we have a del I, no sorry, del j h j 0. Okay? So that del j h j 0 will be replaced by half del t of hm. Okay? So this thing is half del t. So this thing by our gauge condition becomes 1 by 4. Del by del x I, del by del x t of HMM. But then we already have a piece that's minus half del squared HMM by del t del x I. So that becomes minus 1 4 of that. So after using our gauge condition, we get r of 0 I is equal to half r of 0 I is equal to half of del square h j I by del x I del t minus 1 by 4 del square by del t del x I h m m plus half del square h z 1. Right? Now, these two are both h I k type terms, and we know that they're already square. Every time we take a p derivative, it's a new factor of p. So these two terms are known terms of ordinary k. This is the unknown. You know, we know we expect h0i to pick up some value of ordinary k. We don't know what it is. That is the unknown of ordinary k. We'll use that to solve h0. Okay? Now, so all we have to do now is use Einstein's equations. So we've got the equation half del squared of h0i. Let's multiply that by 2. So del squared of h0i is equal to minus del squared hii. So let's plug in what this is. Hgixi was. So remember, this guy was minus 2i. So we get plus del by del x I del by del t of 2 phi. From this term, take this term to the right hand side, multiply q by 2, so that we have del squared by 2 phi. Okay. This term, on the other hand, comes to the other side with a plus, but picks up a minus because HMM has minus 2 phi. The two factors, all factors of 2 cancel. So we get plus. So it comes to this with a plus, but has minus, so minus. Then again, del by del x I. But there's a twist. So that's a 3. Okay. Minus del by del x I del by del x t of phi. Clear? And then plus 16 by 8 of v I a I n. And so if we're going to write, perfect. So we get delta squared h zero I is equal to minus delta delta x I delta delta t of phi plus 16 pi k v a m a delta of r minus p. Okay. Is equal to, so the thing that I add is minus 1 by 4 pi times del by del xi del by del t of f,
where f is the equation,
del square f is equal to 3. Sorry, let me go back to the I'm just taking the d by dx I and d by dx, d by dt outside this equation. So if I can solve, the equation with this source, I can solve the equation with the differentiated source just by taking the result and differentiate it. Okay. So divided as so del square f is equal to 5. But phi is equal to phi itself is equal to minus 4 or present.
Phi is equal to
k by r minus r.
So that's equal to 2x.
acted. So now you see that the solution is F is equal to half minus half minus k by 2 and a
plus k by 2 vr.
the other term comes back in here. So that will give us the minus V dot R A minus R, the whole thing divided by R A minus R cube times there was a minus there was a minus here, I get a minus from this space here. Plus times R minus R A. Because this time we differentiate with respect to R, not with respect to R. Okay? So we have AVI by 2 plus this is V dot R A minus R into R A R minus R A I divided by R A minus R. And I think lambda we should try to write this as AVI by 2 plus VI hat, and then and now we need to get these signs, right? So one of these is R minus R A, the other is R A minus R, so minus sign R minus R A hat J R minus R A hat. This was answer J J I by R minus R A. Okay. So that's what we get when we take the second derivative of when we take the second derivative of F with respect to XI. Okay, so now just putting it all together.
Putting this whole thing together,
what do we have?
In the first term, there should be a R A minus R in the denominator. Because d by dt of f hat that is the denominator, and when we differentiated it with respect to x and
yes.
First of the denominator we
get yes. Completely right.
We are from this side.
This doubles that, it just goes to
the same. That term should be multiplied by k.
And the second term should be multiplied by k by 2, but we got the minus k. So, let me just write it. Thank you. So, the whole thing is k by 2 into vi by R minus R A, VAI by R minus R A, minus, and forget the hats. So, V dot R minus R A into R minus R A, the whole thing by R minus R A cube, sum over all these. Okay, so this thing was del by del x I, del by del t of x. Okay, now we need a formula for x0 I in terms of this problem. So 80i was 4k MAVAI by R by SRI. That was this minus this. So 4k MAVAI. the terms we have to keep? Well, we should keep the terms that are 1 plus 2 phi plus h 0 0 4 from g 0 0. Then, from g 0 I, what terms should we keep? Okay? So, firstly, we have a factor of 2 with g0i, because either mu will become 0 or mu will become 0. Okay. So now we keep plus 2 h0i, and then we get del x0 by del x0, x0 is that, but times vi. Have we messed up on the sign? Let's check. Let's check the sentence. What we really have is g 0 I times b I with a 2. G 0 I is however we define that it's zero. That's a good question. I suppose h0i, it's just. So g0i is simply h0i. And we are interested. So this is evident. Okay. And then finally, what are we left with? Finally, we're left with vi. Minus
This is the Lagrangian accurate order of weakness.
neighborhood.
Indefinitely.
Can we go to the next order? Can we go to the next order to compute the next connection to the post-Newtonian? And the answer is no. The answer is no. Because you see, this order keeps track of energies up to order v to the 4th. But as you can see, unfortunately, now in the next class, an order v to the 5 is not so radiant. Okay. So there's a fundamental difference between Einstein's equations and the equation of Newton. In the equation of Newton, the only degrees of freedom are positions of particles. You could introduce a gravitational force field if you like, but that was a fake. There were no degrees of freedom in space. And any given space, spatial size, if you knew the position of the particles, you knew the gravitational. In the Einsteinian theory, that's not true. In addition to the degrees of freedom associated with the point particles, if you have a point particles, there are degrees of freedom associated with the electromagnetic. Right, so the gravitational. So at some order, apart from giving you a Lagrangian that involves positions of particles, you will need to involve the degrees of freedom that actually lead you to gravitation. Okay? And that turns out to happen in order of v to the 5, as we will see. Okay? So it was a bit lucky that we could do even the first correction, you know, consistently. Then we could take this Newtonian idea to one order. If you try to do it to one order higher than this, that just will not be consistent. Okay? So, this is the best one can do for a Lagrangian involving just point particles. Unless, of course, you may be able to do better if you allow yourself to deal with some dissipated particles or dissipated systems. So, you effectively lose energy to radiation. That will result in dissipation in the system of particles. Okay? So, just as an honest, conservative, classical mechanical system, the equations that we've derived are almost derived in class today are the best you can do in a post-Newtonian connection. And they're quite nice. The question about which we can just write down class
today. It's essentially determined by the position of and velocities of particles. Is that right? HIJ and HZ.
At this order, everything has been determined by position and velocity of a particle. But we have seen in the two classes ago that there are solutions to Einstein's equations that are just pure radiation.
Oh, yeah.
So even with no particles, there are solutions to these equations. So
those can be superimposed.
Exactly. So you could take these equations. So first, you know, the problem that I posed that has been a little deep. Because what I've done, and the way, you know, if I really try to ask, can I solve for the magnetic field given the positions of particles? Really, the answer to that is no. Because on any solution, you can superpose on it gravitational energy. Okay, even the first order, you take our solution we wrote up, and I superpose to that. Gravitational. Now, how about procedure in this? Can anyone tell? Where now proceed? When we try to solve the equations in the systematic procedure, we didn't see any ambiguity. So, how can these two statements? How can A procedure be used and B the statement I just made up in the
initial conditions have to be static. If the particles don't move, your head is assumed to be.
Well, even if the particles are not moving, I could have some gravitational wave.
The time derivative
of phi. Exactly. What we have done is solve these equations in an approximation in which time derivatives are much smaller than space derivatives. That's our expansion parameter. Expansion parameter is velocity. The space derivatives are taken to be of order 1, but time derivatives are taken to be of order epsilon. And maybe solving the equations in such a gravitational radiation, a solution to gravitational radiation, you cannot see in this expansion. Because in a gravitational wave, time derivatives are of the same order as space derivatives. gravitational wave, which is like e to the power I k, k omega t plus kx, where omega is equal to k. So in the gravitational wave, time derivatives are the same space derivatives, same order. So gravitation, what we've been doing is search for solutions in which all variation in time is very slow compared to variation in space. But we will see that this thing is essentially inconsistent to one higher order. Okay? That if you start looking at one higher order, even with slow motion, following except gravitational waves, the energy category of by these gravitational waves will turn out to be about a b to the 5. Okay? So it doesn't affect this regard. But it will qualitatively impact the next one. We see that too. This is
electromagnetism first order AC.
Yes, there's no separation of far. Okay, so now in electromagnetism,
at least electric charges.
In electromagnetism, now once again you can ask, suppose you're trying to do an expansion in velocities. Once again. So let's see. You know that you see, the power radiated is AC. Okay? Power radiated is A squared, which is like V to the 4. It's 4 times what it is. So if you try to do anything beyond